Good morning and welcome to Coastlands Online Church Service. It is good to be with you this morning. We hope you've all cooled down a bit from the heat wave. We now have a little bit of cooler weather and some even rain thrown in there. So we hope you're feeling all a little cooler today. So I just wanted to start off this morning just with a little encouragement to you all. And something that I've been encouraged this week through. So some of you may know, I enjoy running. So I try and run a few times a week. And one thing I really, really struggle with when I run are hills. Now I've been running for years and I still really struggle going up a hill. And often if I look to the top of the hill, I think, oh my goodness me. I don't know if I can make it up there. But if I just concentrate on one step at a time and I just go really slowly up the hill and I concentrate on each step and I don't look as to how far I've got to go and I just go one step at a time, I get there. And God just has really encouraged me in that on many occasions over the years, to be honest. Just saying that I see the bigger picture, Becky. You know, I see the bigger picture and all you've got to do is look to me and focus on me and I will show you each step of the way. I will light your way just as far as you need to see because if I see the bigger picture that you don't need to see right now because it might look a bit scary. And this is the thing, the hill, when I look to the top, it looks scary and I think I can't get to the top. But if I take it one step at a time, I get there. And, you know, I just feel God says something so important in that, you know, he shows us each step of the way because he sees the bigger picture. So we just need to trust in him with all those things in our lives. So we are going to worship together in our first song. So let's do that.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. For I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Everything has changed. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Oh death, where is your sting? Oh fear, where is your power? The mighty King of kings has disarmed. Sweet embrace, I see your scars, your open arms, and the beauty of your face. Through tears of joy, I lift my voice in everlasting praise.
There is nothing as powerful as a changed mind. You can change your hair, your clothing, your address, your spouse, your church, your residence. But if you don't change your mind, the same experience will perpetuate itself over and over again, because everything outwardly changed, but nothing inwardly changed. There is nothing as powerful as a changed mind. You see, if you go on a computer, they have on a computer what they call default settings. So whether you're in Microsoft or whatever it is, whatever program it is, or any kind of program, it has a default. The default sets in the computer some principles and ideas to which the computer is committed. It does not mean that you can't function outside of the default. It just means that even if you deviate from the default, the computer will automatically take you back to default settings. And if you don't want it to do that, it's more than changing the font. You have to change the default. We change the font. And while we're typing, whatever we type in, this font will appear in this font. And it will appear that it has changed. But it really has not changed. Because the moment you go out and come back in again, it will come back up, back to default. This is how most people live their lives, because their default hadn't changed. Their situation hasn't changed. When they're in church, they can get this going. When they're around certain people, they can get this going. When you sing certain songs, they can get that going. When you shout and leap, you can get that going. But when you go back home, you go back to default. So you're going back to default over and over again. And certain, when you get around certain people, you change. And you want to hang around them because as long as you're around them, you feel peace or you feel nice or you feel kind or you feel spiritual or you feel holy. That's not the problem. The problem is when you go back to yourself, you're stuck in the same pattern that you were before, and you can't figure out how to break it. You've cried about it, but you keep going back. You've shouted about it, but you keep going back. You've even prayed about it, but you keep going back. And you can't figure out how somebody who cried for it and shouted for it and sang about it and started going to church on Sunday, and why does this still keep happening to me? I don't know whose prayer I'm breaking into, but I'm breaking into somebody's prayer saying, Lord, why do I keep going through the same things over and over again? I go to church now, I tithe now, I shout now, I leap now, and the Lord sent me here to tell you it's no problem with your sentence, the problem is with your default. Until you change your default, you will always go back to being who you were before because you have never changed your mind. You change your friends, you change your address, you change your phone number, you change the songs you sing, you change everything else, but you didn't change your mind. There is nothing as powerful as a changed mind.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my day. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and I desperate for. Of you are hungry for God? Are you hungry for Him? Woo! Well, this morning we're going to take a look at what is controlling your mind. And before we can answer this question, we really need to ask, well, what is the mind? And actually, that's easier said than done. Scientifically, there are loads of theories as to what the mind is and how it works. But we would probably want to say that the mind is where we think, it's where we reason, it's where we purpose to do things. So it's where processes go on. We process what we see, what we feel, and we process what we experience of the world around us. And so it's a processing place, it's a reasoning place, it's a purposing place, it's where we think. And if we were to look at a more biblical definition of the mind, it would probably boil down to this: it's our inner being. It's who we are, so to speak. So the writers of the Bible were a lot more holistic around their view of the mind. So sometimes they referred to the heart and the mind as though it was the same thing. So for example, in Proverbs chapter 23 verse 7, it tells us that as a man thinks in his heart, so he is. We sometimes refer to the heart as the old ticker, don't we? Our inner being, our mind, our heart is actually what makes us tick, what makes us who we are, and what influences our behavior. So what controls all of that? What is controlling us, our minds, our hearts, how we think? Well, Romans chapter 8 tells us this, that the mind controlled by the sinful nature is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. Now, Paul doesn't mean to say that some people have a mind that just is nothing but sin, and other people have a mind which is nothing but spirit. He's just sharpening up the contrast, if you like, and it's because this is a battle that we all fight. We are born with a sinful nature, and it affects our behavior. In chapter 7 of Romans, Paul is in this quandary saying, you know, I do things I don't want to do. I don't do the things I want to do. So here's an idea. You can take any thought and you can ask this question. Is it leading me toward life? You see, thoughts that lead me toward love or toward peace or towards joy or towards truth or towards good deeds or such things, these sorts of thoughts have the stamp of the Spirit on them. Godly thoughts based on the Word of God,
They bring life and peace. Or we could ask, is this thought leading me towards death? I mean, what could that include? Things like anxiety and fear and lust and greed and bitterness and unforgiveness. These thoughts will not lead us to the life that God wants for us. See, our minds are like a battleground, and we need the Holy Spirit to win. Lifeless thoughts can spiral downwards towards lust and judgmentalism and frustration and anger, all sorts of things. They could lead us into sin, but they could lead us into not achieving all that we could. In Mark chapter 7 and verse 20, Jesus says, it is the thought life that pollutes. The stuff that is going on inside is what pollutes. It's not what is on the outside of us. It's what's going on inside. So what is your inward spring? Fresh water or brackish water? See, whatever is inside will come out. If you are full of the Spirit, you will bear the fruit of the Spirit. If you're full of sinful nature, you will bear the fruit of that. And one of the key verses in understanding what is needed to change our thought life is found in Romans chapter 12 and verse 2. And many of us will know this. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. If we were to look at that passage in the Message version, it says this: don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what he wants from you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you, develops well-formed maturity in you. So how am I going to defeat thoughts that are defeating me? And Paul says we need to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. So how does the mind get renewed? Because you probably know you can't really do this on your own. How do I open myself up to having a renewed mind? Well, here are three quick things. Firstly, be mindful of your mind. You see, with God's help, I begin by becoming aware of the flow of thoughts, desires, perceptions, feelings that typify my mind. Because, you know, we all have patterns of thinking in our minds. There are people who every day, all day long, just have this habitual pattern of bitter thoughts or anxious thoughts or selfish thoughts or lustful thoughts or greedy thoughts. And they probably couldn't even tell you that that's what's going on in their minds. They're just not aware. So instead of living this way, we pray, God, would you help me? Holy Spirit, you're with me. So would you help me with all these thoughts that are knocking on the door of my mind. Would you help me win this battle? And the Holy Spirit begins to flow and other thoughts begin to come that lift me, that put me on an upward spiral towards life and peace. Maybe practical solutions come into my mind. And the more I am flowing with the Spirit, the more the pattern of my thinking changes. So be mindful of your mind, and then we guard our minds. This is what Paul says. We take every thought captive to make it obedient to Christ. All the time, going on right now, even while I am talking, you've got little thoughts marching through your brain. Paul says, every one of them, we're just going to stop them at the door and we're going to ask, hey, thought, are you leading me towards life or are you leading me towards death? If you're leading me towards death, you don't get any further. You don't get free rein of my mind. You're not getting over the threshold here. So we guard our minds, and we can also learn to focus and direct our minds. I can begin to tell my mind where I want it to go. Paul puts it like this, and he uses this kind of language quite a lot in the New Testament. Set your mind on things above. Now that doesn't mean that, you know, we're thinking of clouds and heavenly furniture or something. It's about God's presence and sufficiency right here and right now in my life. And so we set our minds on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father, where God is in charge and he is sufficient and available. So we guard our minds, and then finally we can learn to feed our minds. I can learn to be intentional about what I put my mind to, or what I put into my mind. Put rubbish in and rubbish will come out. Put good stuff in and good stuff will come out. Whatever we immerse our minds in is what our minds will be full of. So the psalmist says, blessed are those who meditate on his law day and night. They are like a tree planted by streams of water. It yields its fruit in season. Its leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. See, these people are attached. They are getting nourishment from something deeper than them. And so they flourish. And Paul says, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent, if anything is praiseworthy, think about such things. See, there's a lot there, isn't there, to think about? You just take one of those phrases, whatever is lovely. What's lovely? Well, flowers and nature and the sea. As I was preparing this, I was looking out of my window and looking at some flowers outside. I mean, flowers, it's hard not to be struck by the beauty of some flowers without thinking what a remarkable thing it is that a flower should exist and look and smell the way it does. What a good thing that God created beauty in our life, that we can appreciate things like this. And as we think about such things, it leads us a little more towards love and peace and joy. And so, how do we change from the inside out? How do we make sure that we're monitoring and guarding and feeding our minds? Well, We do it with the help of the Holy Spirit and God's truth. Amen. Let me pray. Father, thank you for your Holy Spirit. Thank you that you are in the business of transformation, changing us. And Father, we want to ask that you will help us in this whole process of being renewed in our minds, changed, transformed. And Lord, we know that there is a battle going on inside us all. But Father, we thank you that we have the victory through Jesus. We have the victory through the Holy Spirit. We have the victory through the word that you have so painstakingly got into our hands, your word, the Bible. So Lord, we pray that you will help us to use these various things to help us in our thinking and to win this battle. Lord, if there's anyone who's struggling really with something that they really want to know the victory over, something that they may have been struggling with for a very long time, then Father, I pray right now that you would meet with them through your Holy Spirit and help them to put into practice these things that we've talked about today. Lord, may they be overcomers, more than conquerors, through him who has loved us. Father, I pray too for anyone here that is listening that might not know you as their Lord and Saviour. Oh God, we pray that transformation, that renewal from the inside out would be made through the Holy Spirit, that as people think about and meditate on and realise that Jesus died for them on the cross, that he rose again on the third day, such that they might have eternal life and forgiveness of sin and be reconciled to God. Lord, I pray that the reality of these things may come into their thinking and into their inner being, into their hearts, and they will be changed. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation to let it all go. I see it now, I'm laying it down, and I know that I need you. I run to the Father, I fall into grace. I'm done with the hiding, no reason to wait. My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. So I run to the Father again. And again, and again, and again. Oh, oh, oh. You saw my condition, had a plan from the start. Your son for redemption, the price for my heart. And I don't have a contact for that kind of love. I don't understand.
Service with us. Thank you for joining, we really hope you have a fantastic and blessed week ahead. A little cooler, I think, this week for us all, and we look forward to seeing you next week. Take care, God bless.